Thank you so much for joining us on this session. My name is Mathieu Lamolle, Senior Advisor at the ITC. Let us first thank ISD for hosting us for this session, Deforestation-Free Value Chains, How Can We Allocate the Burden of Change? Exciting session. Thanking also co-organizers of this session, UNEP and the World Resources Institute, and distinguished panelists, thank you so much for joining us. On the program, you have seen a lot of words, how can we get back on track? Fragmented world, geopolitics, problems and issues. And here we talk about allocating the burden. Trade measures have that capacity that there are some issues coming together with implementation. And we need to allocate the burden, or at least find ways to make that in as fairness as possible. Burden is one thing, benefits is other things. How can we make sure that it's not always the same that we pay the cost and bear the burden of change in value chains? And at the same time, I would like to ask my panelists to also think about how can we make sure that the benefits are also not always going into the same pockets. So with that session, we would like to break some silos and benefit from deep knowledge from our panelists. I will first hand over to my executive director, Pamela Coke Hamilton, for some remarks. And thank you very much, Pamela. You may stand up and address the floor. Yes, please. Thank you.
Stand up. Thank you. Okay, thank you very much. It's great to be back here. Good afternoon and welcome to this session on deforestation-free global value chains. I'm really grateful to ISD for co-hosting this with us and also their trade and sustainability hub. I think this is going to be a really good couple of days because we're going to discuss real stuff, you know? And also to World Resources Institute, to UNEP, our session partners, and of course, you know, the hard work that's been done to pull this together. And common fund for commodities, of course. As you all can see, we have a really impressive lineup of panelists, and we really look forward to the discussions later on. Together, they'll be giving us a comprehensive look at how to ensure that the forests we rely on for our livelihoods and indeed for our planet's survival can continue to provide for generations to come, while also making sure that the burden doesn't fall solely on the producing countries, especially those small businesses and vulnerable communities. And the reason for that is surprisingly simple, that we get far better results if we work together rather than by working in silos. In other words, true to the theme of the ISD Hub, cooperation will be key for conserving our forests and for doing so fairly. This is really urgent work, and I think we all know why. And the evidence is showing that our efforts thus far to protect our forests are still falling short. According to our partners at the World Resources Institute, the global production of commodities that are integral to our daily lives, such as soy, cattle, palm oil, wood, cocoa, coffee, and rubber, meant that the world lost over 25% of its global tree cover over a 15-year period. That's one quarter of the world's cover. That's kind of frightening. But these same commodities provide crucial livelihoods for people around the world, across all regions. They're essential to ensuring global food security, and it's often the small producers that are responsible for a massive proportion of production. In Vietnam, for instance, 95% of the coffee comes from smallholder farmers. What we'll hear about today are the various efforts underway focused on forest conservation. And we'll also hear about what this means for the people who actually produce these commodities, people who know firsthand why our forests matter, people who are often at the front lines of tackling forest loss and degradation, people we must learn from and whose experiences must be shared far and wide, especially with policymakers who are looking at how trade and trade policy can help. Because if we don't, their businesses won't just suffer, they'll fail, just when we need them most. More and more, we're seeing governments put in place trade measures seeking to tackle deforestation head on. They're taking different forms. For instance, the EU-Kenya Economic Partnership Agreements chapter on trade and sustainable development includes a dedicated article on trade and forests, featuring a commitment to share knowledge and experience that can help make deforestation-free supply chains possible and successful. And of course, there's the EU deforestation regulation for deforestation-free products, with its rapidly approaching deadline for traders to put these new rules in place. We've been looking at what this regulation means for producers around the world and how to help them prepare. For instance, Ecuador exports $3.3 million each year in coffee to the EU and $253 million in cocoa. Our analysis shows that the new regulation would affect 18% of the EU-bound coffee exports and 24% of its cocoa exports. So from private initiatives to trade agreements, from new regulations to national standards, it's clear that we're well on our way to turning things around for our forests. But we must also keep in mind that what these various efforts mean for the smallest producers, especially when it comes to proving compliance with these initiatives and thus remain part of these global value chains. It is a big lift, even for those farmers that are already taking steps to limit their production's environmental impacts. Here's why. When you're looking at a supply chain, you've got to factor in the many countries involved. Even if you're not exporting directly to a market and a trade-related environment regulation is in place, you may be selling inputs to another producer who is, and they'll need to be able to prove where their inputs came from and how these were produced. So if you look at Malaysian-produced rubber gloves, for instance, they'll often source their inputs from neighboring Thailand. And if Malaysia then wants to sell these gloves abroad to a market with trade-related environmental regulations, they'll have to account for both their final product and the Thai inputs that they sourced along with any others. It's fiendishly complex, and we can't shy away from the details there. Right now, as more of these measures come into effect, we must make sure that we draw from the expertise and the experience we've gained from the work that's already underway. And those will be invaluable for ensuring that the right accompanying measures are in place and to see where harmonization is possible so that producers aren't having to comply with too many competing standards and regulations, many of which have overlapping requirements. That's why we'll soon be launching a new deforestation-free gateway to help make it easier to share the information that producers will need for meeting due diligence requirements across the supply chain, and that governments will need as they consider how best to support SMEs. This new gateway builds on our tried and tested online tools, like the standards map and trade map. They're tools that ITC has developed to help traders navigate the intricacies of the international markets, especially in our fast-paced global economy. And we're constantly updating them so that SMEs can get the information they need when they need it. It's fitting that we're having the conversation in parallel to the WTO's 13th Ministerial Conference, and the negotiations underway just a few minutes from here are showing just how hard cooperation can be in practice. Often, too often, we're seeing a trading system where discord and inertia are the order of the day, where cooperation falls by the wayside in favor of old divides and national politics, where the path of least resistance wins out. We cannot afford to keep putting off the tough conversations and making the tough calls. And we know especially those of us who have spent years trying to make trade work for the people who need it most, that the trading system holds far greater potential for positive change than we often give it credit for. In closing, it's a system that also has many tools and forums already in place for helping solve some of the world's most pressing challenges, including those that affect our natural world. One of the most important forums for these conversations includes, of course, the WTO's very own Committee on Trade and Environment. That's why I'm delighted that we have that committee's chair, His Excellency Jose Valencia, Ecuador's ambassador to the WTO, as our keynote speaker this afternoon. Jose, the floor is yours.
I thank you, Director Pamela Cook Hamilton, for her introduction. I want to extend first my gratitude to the ISD and ITC for inviting me to participate in this conversation. I wish to make it clear that the perspectives I'm share are drawn from my experience representing Ecuador and my role as the chair of WTO Committee on Trade and Environment. However, I have to say that these views are personal and reflect a commitment to our planet's future from the standpoint of my country, of course. We find ourselves at a pivotal juncture, confronted with a triple environmental crisis of climate change, pollution, and biodiversity loss, a situation acknowledged repeatedly at the WTO. It is imperative that we reiterate this message to underscore the global context demanding urgent and unified action. I have to solve this problem because my screen is getting, okay. I think I come here, it's gonna be better. Well, I was saying it's crucial to remember that the combined effects on this triple crisis negatively impact forests worldwide. Forests, as we know, play an essential role as Earth's lungs, regulating the planet's temperature and humidity, and they are vital for the survival of all species, including humans. This holds particular significance for developing countries, which are home to the majority of the world's largest forests. These forests are not only rich in biodiversity, but are also crucial to the livelihood of and economies of many people. Considering the global impact of deforestation, trade has a strategic role in addressing this environmental emergency and becoming a part of the solution, as we always say. Our trade policies and practices must evolve to protect forests, encourage reforestation, and promote sustainable development. The responsibility of protecting forests lies in both wood producing and consumer countries and the wood industry, encompassing developed and developing nations and both public and private sectors. Our strategy should be progressive, yet relentless, focusing on adaptation, building resilience, and maintaining collaborative efforts. Each country has a role to play within its borders and responsibility to preserve its natural heritage. While unilateral policies and initiatives that have international effects might seem appealing for their rapid implementation, the absence of multilateral dialogue can lead to mistrust and exacerbate issues. To illustrate, from Ecuador's and other countries' standpoint, concerns arise regarding the European Green Pact and the push for deforestation-free products. I commend the words of Director Cook Hamilton on this matter, but I will go to a more, if you want, political view of the matter. While the objectives are laudable, it's crucial to remember a well-known Latin American adage: no hay que llegar primero, sino saber llegar, implying that the manner of the journey is more important than being the first to arrive. Our collective goal is environmental sustainability, for sure, but it's essential to acknowledge the unique circumstances and challenges each trading partner faces in our shared pursuit of the global sustainable economy. Last year, Ecuador and other countries voiced their concerns to European authorities regarding the EU deforestation regulation, which could inadvertently penalize vulnerable communities, small and medium-sized producers, not for causing deforestation, but for their inability to prove their compliance. We seek a more meaningful dialogue with the EU, committed to forest protection and sustainability, to combat deforestation and promote sustainable development and trade practices. We must engage in dialogue that transcends borders and sectors, fostering mutual interests and building trust. Engaging in dialogue and agreements should not imply delays or endless discussions. Given the urgency of the environment crisis, we need to unite, understand one another, and act decisively for our planet and future generations. Let's commit to working together more diligently than ever. Thank you. Thank you very much once again.
Trade and climate measures that work for all, what does that really mean on the ground? And here I'm just suggesting we have the 3 minutes hearing from a small company from Ghana, a short video message that is being directly coming here from Kumasi. Please, can you launch the video message? Thank you.
Greetings from Fairfax to everyone. It is an honor for Fairfax to join in and discuss a menace that lies at the heart of our mission. At Fairfax, we believe in harnessing the power of business to create positive change, both for our environment and the communities we engage with. Every second witnesses the disappearance of a forest area equivalent to a soccer field from Earth due to continuous tree felling, driven by the growing demand of resources like soil, palm oil, rubber, cocoa, and coffee. According to Statista in Ghana, some 18,000 hectares of forest have been lost as of 2022, a 7,300 hectares increase over the previous years. The sources state that the total loss in Ghana during that time span was 93.6 kilohectares, or 9.3% of the total loss of trees covering during the same period due to timber exploitation, mining, and agricultural expansion. In recognition of this unsustainable trajectory, and with the increasing consumer awareness of sustainable products, Fairfax has committed itself to a supply chain that is free from deforestation. The brand aims to offer consumers products that can be traced back and verified as sustainable. Our journey towards a climate positive chocolate supply chain begins with a fundamental commitment to the well-being of those in the front lines, that is the farmers. Recognizing their pivotal role, we have taken concrete steps to improve their living conditions and ensure a decent income. In doing so, we proudly pay our farmers a premium of $600 per ton of cocoa beans, the highest so far in the region. This does not only acknowledge their hard work and dedication, but also empowers them to have a more fulfilling life. However, our commitment extends beyond financial support. We strategically identify regions where our raw materials originate, working closely with stakeholders who share our vision for sustainable practices. Fairfax has chosen to source cocoa from dynamic agroforestry producers who rely on the continuous construction of natural forests. This deliberate choice reflects our belief in sustainable and regenerative agricultural practices that harmonize with the environment rather than deplete it. To ensure transparency and accountability, Fairfax has implemented a robust traceability system. We request geospatial monitoring reports annually from our suppliers, providing essential data on farmers, farm sizes, yield estimates, and farm polygons and shapes. By aligning our business practices with environmental preservations, we are not only ensuring longevity of our chocolate production, but also contributing to a healthier planet for future generations. This is what Fairfax aims to do, promoting sustainable practices, ensuring a climate-positive supply chain. Thank you for your attention, and together, let us continue this journey towards a more sustainable and compassionate future. Fairfax, creating jobs, loving chocolates.
Loving chocolate, yes, definitely. From market premiums to forest conservation and traceability or monitoring land and yield, I'd like to turn to you, Fred, as Deputy Director at the WRI for the Forest Program. Can you tell us a little bit about the role of technology in this? Is there a magical button we can press, and how can we make it more accessible to FairAfric and all the likes in developing countries? Floor is yours. Thank you.
Thank you, Matteo. The magic button is here. I'll start my 5 minutes. But it's a good point. And I want to say, like, we, I think, in the forest community are very happy that forests get more and more discussed in trade. Because it has been a big part of the environmental movement to say that they have to stop deforestation. As soon as it's us and them, you have lost. Now with trade, it's us, it's the consumer, it's the producer, and it's the in-between, the companies who have this burden now that we talk about. And I think about, so what are these burdens? To come back to your question, so I see three levels of burden, and I go from what I think is the easiest and so to something which is more hard to do. I think actually the easiest is what we're in now is actually detecting, verifying, you know, the deforestation and degradation parts. There are so many free satellites, European Space Agency, NASA, Google Earth. The Norway has this 5-meter resolution data, 10, 20-meter, 30-meter data, global, weekly. There are maps. The Joint Research Center comes up with the maps. My own organization comes weekly with maps on Global Forest Watch. So that part, I think, is the burden is light. It doesn't say it's nothing. People still need to look at the data and do something with it, but it's that burden is light, can be easily centralized, and everybody can benefit from that. Part of that is something on geolocation. It's nice that you know that there's deforestation, but you need to know, is it this in your supply chain? That's harder and more difficult, but it's not a barrier. It's nothing new. GPS has existed for 30 years. Most farmers know where their land is. It's effort. There's new AI tools to do it, to map land and boundaries. But sure, that's an effort. It's not a barrier, but it's an effort to do that. Then I come to the second one, which I think is a much more harder for data as well as for level of order and burden. And I think that comes partly to the countries and the producers is legality. So you need to produce deforestation free, but you also need to produce legal. It has to do a lot with tenure, and we know that in 60% of the lands in tropical countries usually don't have formal tender, but informal tender, how do you deal with that? And how do you deal with smallholders who go into, you know, protected areas or areas which are not entirely legal? You know, it's usually much more gray what is legal and not legal, and so we have to deal with that. There's a lot of data about it. There's also satellite data, but also a lot of working with communities to find that out and what this local practice is. So I think that more. And then the last part, and we heard it a little bit as well, the introduction is of the traceability. I think that's the hardest part we're working in these trades. How do we have these thousands of fields? It's all very interesting, but how do we get this, find out that that goes into my chocolates, or that it goes into the Cadbury, or that goes into the Mars bars? And that is difficult. Thousands of fields, thousands of middlemen who go to middlemen. Different commodities have very different ways of getting it to the markets. And I think that's where there's a lot of burden as well for the companies, the consumer goods forums, the consumers, the big companies who have to do a lot of investment there. There's also some new tools. 40% of the big companies already have pilots going on to do this tracking. That's great, but it's still pilots and it's only 40%. So that needs to go to 100% and hopefully to standard operating procedures. Some other good news in that, I just saw in January news from ADM, they shipped the first soy to the EU, complete traceable soy from North America, from the US. Cargill making great announcement of stopping deforestation in the entire chain on soy in a few countries in Latin America. So clearly, companies are moving that way and doing these things. Then there is, on these three things, what I just said, which is the burdens, I think, becomes harder and harder. Now, everything becomes much harder when smallholders are involved. We just heard it. Smaller farms, usually a bit more unclear where the boundaries are. difficult supply chains, and that is where there's a lot of burden, because we don't want to exclude those people. How can we actually fund that? And that is the burden on, I think, countries, consumer groups, large holders. I see there the biggest difficulty in getting those included in the world trade.
Thank you so much, Fred. Technology can bring magics to the world. I mean, it can be very complicated, but at the same time, fascinating. Now, of course, the way this is working on the ground might be very different. I would like to maybe turn to you, Ieva, from ISD's perspective and all the studies and experiences you've had in some countries. Maybe there are some lessons learned on what works the best and what are the challenges, the most common issues you've seen in actually moving forward with this trade-related and environment measures. So please take the floor.
Thank you so much, Matthew, and thank you so much for organizing this excellent panel. Really, both Executive Secretary and Ambassador Valencia provided so much inspiration to be discussing this issue further, because we know that the situation is really complex. We just heard about burden sharing and the need for cooperation. And this is what is also coming out from our research. ISD's Voluntary Sustainability Standards and Initiative has a long-standing experience working on agriculture, fisheries, carbon, and forestry standards. And our recently published paper called Measures to Enhance Forest Conservation and Reduce Deforestation seeks to illustrate that examples of government, but also public sector measures that are put in place in five countries: in Costa Rica, in Peru, in Rwanda, Indonesia, and Gabon, trying to address the deforestation problem while exploring potential synergies with voluntary sustainability standards. So among the measures that we have overviewed in this report, there are payments for ecosystem services. I think something that Costa Ricans would really recognize very fast. Land tenure systems, which are more relevant in Peru, forest landscape restoration strategies, Rwanda, as well as national and private certification schemes of sustainable forest management that come from Indonesia and from Gabon. And the experiences of those countries provide interesting starting points for different governments in developing countries that try to preserve their forests and comply with emerging regulations, try to see how the sustainable value chains can really support their efforts as they're looking for a pathway towards a deforestation-free commodity production and actually building on their productive capacity in that regard. Some of principal takeaways from this work are as following. Reducing deforestation, improving forest conservation, it normally requires a combination of measures. One measure is not sufficient. Really, we need to look into the very complex regulatory and practical environment of measures that a country needs to adopt domestically. That also means that a big enabling environment is required to support producers, forestry operators, and smallholders in complying with policy measures that prevent deforestation and enhance forest conservation. When we think about that enabling environment, we also need to continuously think about how that must be extended to our international trading environment and what our organizations and institutions can do about that. Our research also proves that we need to engage multiple actors and mobilize funds. I think this is what Ambassador Valencia was speaking about. We need to mobilize that from both public and private sectors to support efforts to reduce deforestation and enhance forest conservations. There are also some results showing that voluntary sustainability standards can really be employed to complement and support the implementation of measures to enhance forest conservation and deforestation, but they need to be applied where it fits best. I heard Fred speaking about the burdens and of different levels of burdens. What our research shows that there is a cost to that. The systems that we need to apply are not only digital, but sometimes you need to employ the physical monitoring systems, and the combination of both can really be challenging, both in terms of human resources, but also financial resources. The last learning is really that a lot of those measures are country specific. The problems that create deforestation in each individual countries are not the same. Some of them are linked to political insecurities. Some of them are being linked to land management issues. Our attempts to reverse deforestation have been unevenly successful. We all know of the successes of Costa Rica, but a lot of countries are still trying to catch up to those successes. And it doesn't mean that a set of measures can be automatically transposed to the different jurisdictions. However, having said that, our research shows that there are lessons that can be learned from countries that have comparable set of problems, and we need to be really getting together and discussing them more. Thank you, Matthew.
Thank you so much, Eva. I'm hearing a lot about those multiple perspectives in the ecosystem of both measures and environmental challenges that we try to merge and converge towards something that is more meaningful for global value chains and fighting deforestation. I would like now to turn to Asad as head of trade and environment policy at the UNEP. Thank you so much for being with us. I'd like to ask maybe for also your perspective on this nexus between trade, environment and development. I mean, what makes it work? What can reconcile trade and environment? And we heard also in the context of MC13 how this environmental and sustainability agenda is moving more and more onto the plate of the negotiators. So we are eager to hear your thoughts about this. Thank you so much.
Well, thank you very much. My name is Asad Naqvi. I'm head of the economic and trade policy team at UNEP, and also for the Partnership for Action on Green Economy, and that's what brings the nexus together. But let me first thank ITC for being such a great partner in hosting this event. We are grateful to you for all the heavy lifting and hard work. And secondly, warm welcome on behalf of UNEP Ambassador for being here with us today. So if I look at UNEP's engagement on trade and environment over the last 25 years and close engagement with WTO and ITC, there are a few lessons which are emerging very clearly which link to the forest debate that we are having. Number one, I think we must admire, appreciate, beyond the loudest voices that are possible, the efforts that developing countries have made so far in protecting, preserving, restoring, regenerating forests. And that becomes even more important if you look at the economic and development challenges that they are facing. So since I work more on the macroeconomic side, I do look at what is the pressing challenge for developing countries just in terms of servicing their debts. And many of them, like 60 of them, are almost at the verge of debt default now. And they are still making effort to keep the sustainability agenda alive. There is huge and increasing inequality and poverty issues. The fiscal space is shrinking every day. And losing their share in the global market is making it even worse to have the foreign exchange reserves which are needed to service the debts, et cetera. And this is among the so many other challenging and pressing challenges that they face every day. So when I talk or when I work with the policymakers from developing countries, I really feel that what they are doing is amazing in the circumstances. Just in terms of borrowing money for running the country, they have to pay much higher debt servicing and interest rates compared to their richer brothers and sisters in the global community. So that's where I think the debate should start from, that is the nexus of trade, environment, and development, and looking at the realities of those policymakers who are dealing with every day. And that's where UNEP comes in. So we have developed a model of supporting countries on this issue, what we call the system dynamic model, in which the environment, development, poverty, and inequality issues come in one model of economic development and financial development planning. And where the policymakers can see that what type of combination of policy and investment options will lead to what type of economic growth and employment creation results, what type of impact on the environmental dimensions, and what is there on the social dimensions of the economy. Number two, the efforts that developing countries are making that has benefits for everyone in the global community, including the global citizens who live in any part of the world. Not only that it helps them to become part of the global supply chain and get international access to the market, which is much needed and desired and required for delivering development, but also that the forest and the nature-based of the economy is the backbone. It is the fallback position. It is the insurance. It is the social protection of the poorest of the poor. This is the sector where we see our work on GDP of the poor, where the poor people rely in any type of circumstances that came, and we did a study, a global study, when the pandemic came. The urban laborer went back to their villages and depended either on their smallholder farms or the non-timber forest products to get any type of livelihoods. The nature-based sector of the economy contributes probably 3 to 4% in the global GDP, which is almost negligible. But when you do a study on the GDP of the poor, it is the 60 to 80% of the GDP of those who earn less than $2.5 a day. So investing in, let's say, forest, and that's why I think developing countries do it and continue to do it, or in smallholder farms, is the best poverty reduction strategy that we have. And that will save the global climate agenda, and that will save the planet in terms of like completely going out of balance. I think there is a third part, which is what is triggering it? And there is a tension between the nature side or nature sector of the economy, which is between the forest and agriculture. Agriculture is, for the moment, from the studies, is the biggest source of deforestation or delivering or leveraging deforestation. And that's where our work comes in on fossil fuel and agriculture subsidies. We do believe that the subsidies that are currently in place does encourage agriculture to probably create harm for forest-based sectors of the economy. We are not working on taking out subsidies, but they can be repurposed in a way which creates more opportunities for creating economic growth, possibly through forestation and investing in forest or non-timber forests, but also by repurposing them into the poverty reduction areas which have nature-positive impact. So our work with ILO on green jobs in the nature-based sectors of the economy or on the nature-based infrastructure investments is some of those examples which demonstrate that how you can create jobs and economic growth by redirecting your subsidies that you currently have. We have done a lot of work with ITC, Ambassador, on trade and environment hub project, which come up with clear ideas of how the investment can be redirected. But before closing, I would probably, and I will go into details if needed later on, but in closing, I think there are two or three messages which is coming in. Number one, green trade, sustainable trade, deforestation is more likely to be successful when the overall economy and the overall finance become supportive mechanism for these things. Otherwise, we will have successful projects, but they will be only successful as long as the project is there. A smallholder farm in Kenya, in Tanzania, in Uganda, who wants to go organic, will not be able to face the $2 billion subsidy which is there for the agrochemicals. So unless we change the global financial architecture and the way economy is working, it's very difficult. And that's where we, as UNEP, offer three services, and I will just be very brief on that. Number one, policy coherence is important. Forest policy, agriculture policy, industrial policy, they do not develop in a vacuum. They are part of a national economic development planning process. And that's where we try to bring, and we have created a partnership. It's called the Partnership for Action on Green Economy between UNEP, UNDP, ILO, UNIDO, and UNITAR, where we try to bring at least the five ministries in a government together to talk about what is the net development gain that they want to have. So policy coherence is one part of this. Number two, even if you have a good policy and you don't have financing behind it, things don't work. So we have UNEP Finance Initiative, which you may have heard about, which is working with the private sector institutions to bring financing behind those policies which aim to create a positive impact for people and planet. We have a public finance program, which is looking at subsidies, taxes, incentives, and helping countries to align them with the global sustainability and social development and poverty reduction agenda. And even if you have policy and finance, and you don't have the capacity, things are not likely to deliver results. So we have a capacity building program which helps countries to better use financial resources that they have currently on their hand, both domestically and internationally, to support these efforts. So this is part of a larger package in which we support deforestation-free products, just as one part of the solution to save say, forest, and that is not the only part. So we look at a broader mix of things.
Thank you so much, Asad. Global finance mechanisms that contribute to economic growth and that support this transition with sustainability, deforestation-free value chains, all of that is of course, a very nice objective. Now, of course, we know how the finance world works. I mean, you invest in something that brings returns. And so the question is, who wants to invest in a very high-risk deforestation risky area with smallholders with little traceability and little tools? So we need to have finance, but we need to also have innovative mechanisms to make it work, and to make it work for those that need to have the adequate support on the ground, smallholders, farmers, cooperatives, those that are maybe in some risky areas. So I would like to turn to you, Peter. Impact investment, what does that mean? How does the Common Fund for Commodities work on this and actually address this fundamental disconnect between big finance and actually how it works on the ground with small entities? What makes it work?
Thank you, and thank you, Asad, for providing me with that launch pad. One would have thought we'd coordinated ahead. Before I go on, and I want to point to a few initiatives and some engagements, both from our portfolio, but also from our work with stakeholders, I, of course, also need to just thank you all, both ISD, ITC, World Resources Institute, and UNEP for inviting me here. It's an honor to be sitting among you, and thank you, Ambassador, as well, for the inaugural remarks. So, as mentioned, I'll be pointing to a few examples from our portfolio on how we engage with smallholders to, among other things, help them overcome this obstacle that is to be part of deforestation-free value chains. So, when we talk about the allocation of the burden, before we even get to the distributional and equitable questions, we should also talk about how do we minimize it. That's the first step. And there was a remark made by Pamela. She mentioned that there is this ITC initiative to provide a gateway for the sharing of information, for instance. That's one example of how we, through information sharing, can minimize those costs that it implies to become part of these deforestation-free value chains. Now, a bit more on the ground, and specifically when it relates to the involvement of smallholders, as also presented previously by the panel, and in other discussions, this does not only include remote sensoring. It also includes going into the field. And these are quite cost-heavy interventions. If you want to send a field team to a smallholder farmer in Ecuador, you know, this can be miles away from any hub where you'd usually find these technical experts. And so combining that remote sensoring with the in-field expertise that allows for the data gathering and for the inclusion of smallholders, that's about application of technology, and that requires investments. That could be investments coming from the EU. In this case, we've been supplying some investments towards a company that helps smallholders become integrated into and compliant with the EUDR, because also, as mentioned by the ambassador, this is to a large extent about compliance, not necessarily about avoiding deforestation measures. A lot of smallholders know that they should be avoiding these, and they're already implementing these measures for alternative livelihoods. Now we need to show compliance. So, for instance, we've been financing Meridia, which is a company that combines the services of remote sensoring technologies with in-field observations that allow for the inclusion of smallholders into value chains. This is one way of increasing the spread and the reach, getting out to those smallholders and doing it at a cost that allows for the integration. So now we've reduced the burden somewhat. The barriers to entry for smallholders have become lower. There is still the question of distribution. And when it comes to the equitable distribution, I would have liked to say that, you know, the answer is before us. It was before us a bit earlier. Fabrique made an excellent presentation of the way that they work with smallholders by making much more direct links between primary production and the consumption and the buyers in the consuming countries. As also mentioned, the way that global value chains often works is through a complex set of intermediaries with little direct linkages between these smallholders and the consumers. So there is also very little interest among the producers or the processors in the global north to have that smallholder engagement. They could not care less in many instances. But for companies such as Fairafrique, who has that direct link with smallholders and for whom that smallholder engagement is part of value proposition to processors and consumers, they have a distinct interest in covering those costs and allocating that burden of change more equitably along the value chain. So we invest and have done so historically directly in companies such as Fairafrique. I wanted to bring also the case of Colcocoa, who's also a known suspect in ITC circles. Gabriela Alvarez, the female founder of this company, is also an ITC expert. I believe she still consults with them. She's put up an amazing system that links more than 2,000 smallholder cocoa growers in Colombia to processors in the EU. And she has been receiving an incredible uptick in interest after the EUDR has been moving closer because she has been implementing that technology of traceability since a long time. And they know that she's a reliable partner when it comes to compliance, not only with the EUDR right now, but also with heavier reporting obligations when it comes to biodiversity, et cetera, in the future. And now, and I promise to make this short because I know you also want to take some questions, Metro. But I did see that we were a bit ahead of schedule, so I took my liberties. I want to throw in a final wildcard, and this is for you policymakers out there. We need to not only look at this as a question of allocating a burden and costs, but there is actually an opportunity. Once we've implemented this system of monitoring that comes with the EUDR, we not only have a system for monitoring and screening for the negative effects of commodity productions, we actually have a technology that can, with few alterations, be used for also monitoring positive effects of agriculture and of smallholder agriculture. And as pointed out by the ambassador earlier, smallholders are at the front line of this battle against climate change for biodiversity. They can deliver these ecosystem and environmental services effectively. And if we allow for the monetization of this, either through consumers being willing to pay by the EU, who are now seeking to exclude the polluters, they could also choose to pay the cleaners. If we decide to put money towards remunerating those positive practices, then smallholder inclusion does not only become a question of cost minimization, it becomes an investment case. You can make money from including smallholders who will be doing the cleaning. And I hope to see opportunities along those lines in the future. For me as an investor, it makes sense. It makes sense for the smallholders, and it does for all of us concerned about climate change and biodiversity. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Peter. Positive inspiration from your remarks. This is great. I'm so grateful to all of you for your remarks. We have time for a few questions from the audience, so please raise your hand. Sir, here, we have one question in the front, and then one lady over here. We take your two questions, and then we'll see from the floor who to answer, please.
Thank you.
Please also mention your name and affiliation. That would be great. Thank you.
My name is Absalom Adam. I'm an ESG consultant. I'm teaching this subject, and my question is regarding the incentives that there are for deforestation. There are many incentives for doing that. And my question is about a carbon footprint accounting of a product, say a chocolate, in the supply chain. What is, in fact, the carbon footprint of, in terms of accounting of this product? And how do you deal with it when you check with the ghost that is not in the room, the multinational corporations and the consumer? Because if I were to be in the duty-free shop right now and I would like to buy a chocolate, it would be a kind of European chocolate. And this European chocolate from the big brands won't have any accounting of the product that was produced. And so we have multinational corporations that are behind it. What price are they going to pay? And what price are we, the consumers, are going to pay for deforestation? Because these are big incentives to carry on with it. So I think that we have to at least address these questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I will take a second question from here.
Thank you very much. Actually, my question quite resonates with yours. So I'm Sophie from Fairtrade International. My question was also on the how to reward. So, you know, we speak a lot about punitive dimension, but there is also the fiscal incentives in producer and in consumers countries. I'm also thinking of criteria in public procurement, and also wanted to mention the issue of prices, fair prices, because that's also, I think, a question of the root causes that we need to address. So basically, how can we reward those who are making efforts on deforestation through a range of policies? Thank you.
Thank you very much. Maybe we start with those two questions. Fred, would you like to start?
Yeah, a little bit on the carbon cost of chocolates. We wrote about it, so yeah, it's on our website. And yes, there's considerable carbon cost in chocolates. But as you know, we are talking for more than 20 years on carbon prices on anything, and we're still not there. And yes, there is the voluntary carbon market, which is quite big, they do, but it would be great. You know, we have now in the US that every, in different states, where you see the kilocalories, if you buy a hamburger, you know, what are the calories? It would be great if something would be the cost of carbon on these. Having said that, I don't see the political will there coming soon, but I hope to be wrong.
Yeah, I can ping up on it really quickly, and I guess the basic answer is that as of right now, there is no price on deforestation really, and what there is quite minimal. What, and it might also very well be, I'm not in policy circles, but I do tend to follow because it has implications for my work, and one of the things that we're seeing is with SFDR and the more strict disclosure mechanisms, we might be moving towards a reality where big companies, including big confectionery producers in Europe, for instance, will have obligations to report on their carbon footprint, not only in their in-house processing, but also their scope 3, what happens through their supply chain, etc. That brings us closer to a reality where we can start holding them accountable, and where it's not necessarily a reality where a price is paid through regulatory efforts. It might be a reality where consumers could be willing to pay a price. This is, for now, theoretical, but at least consumers have historically shown themselves to some level willing to compensate producers for positive environmental practices. But as evidenced by the EUDR, it has not been sufficient. So hopefully the next step will be to put on top of that regulation that also is punitive when it comes to negative impacts, but also rewards those positive impacts that are generated along the value chain. And the technology, as mentioned, which also comes with EUDR, brings us one step closer to that reality.
I was wondering, with regards to the rewards and incentives, Yeva and Asad, if you'd like to also make a compliment on this. I guess you may have some experiences as well from the research, and then also from your side, if that's okay.
Yes, and thank you. Just a very quick comment. Yes, I do think that financial incentives could be part of an answer if a country can allow themselves to do so. And this is where so many challenges are coming in. We have seen in our research that, for example, Costa Rica has introduced the payments for ecosystem services. So basically that is a financial rewards mechanism to landowners for protecting their forests. It is also supportive towards the ecotourism services that increase local economical gains, but you are not in a position to provide such payments if you are cash strapped. So not every government can go that route, but there are certainly opportunities there. The problem is that, of course, those expenses are not coming from the consumer countries. This is what Peter has mentioned. And the gentleman over here has asked a question. So the other thing is also the question about public procurement instrument. As a trade person, I believe that it can be a strong instrument and it can create strong incentives, but it would also come with a regulatory complexity that many producing countries would need to overcome. I'll stop here. I'll just leave a bit of time to Asad.
Yeah, so thank you. Number one, we have a long way to create a fair world. So so the expectations are high, and I think we need to really come together. It will require broader partnerships to make this world a more fairer place than it is. Adam, your question is at the heart of the problem that we are facing. We have been advocating in sustainability movement, in environmental sustainability movement for a long time, that this is the only place in the judicial system of the world where the innocent has to prove that he's not guilty. And that is through the certification and labeling schemes. So anybody who is harming the planet does not need any label, any certification, anything, especially in agriculture and nature-based products. I think we have to turn the table. And we have turned the table, and the example is from the electronic appliances, where in Europe, if you buy any appliance, it has an energy efficiency label. We have done it, as you said, on the calorie side. This is the next battlefield where we need to go, that every agricultural-based product or nature-based product should have a carbon, not only carbon, I would say, but also agrochemical pesticide use, because that is what is harming the planet. And then we will be an equal or fair playing field for everyone, and consumer can choose whether they want to buy a product which has high carbon footprint or higher pesticide footprint or agrochemical footprint. So I fully support you. I do agree with you that I don't see the political movement, but that does not mean that we can leave it off the agenda. It's always in human history that few people have changed the world, and I see that many of those few people are probably in this room. So if we take it forward together, I think we will get there.
Good news, we are at MC13. So yes, there are challenges, but we can influence and set the agenda at least a little bit. This session will be uploaded online. So for those online, hi, and you can rewatch it. For those here and those that could not link, of course, they will be able to watch again this session. There will be also notes shared and some key messages, a kind of a short summary. So before closing, I would like to ask all the panelists to reflect a little bit on that key message that will come for this final conclusions of this discussion on how we can set this political will, how we can actually influence a little bit more the thinking at MC13 and beyond with regards to this allocation of the burden and to making things a little bit more efficient and less costly for everyone to embark on those deforestation-free global value chains. Maybe I will start in the same order we started, starting with you, Fred.
Getting it into trades, getting it, having at MC13, not only lawyers, but actually people who know what to talk about, smallholders, farmers, remote sensing specialists, field specialists would be very helpful. But I agree, if we want it, we can do it. And the regulation, the world is, and the consumers are ready for it. Because in the end, it's the consumer who buys the fair trade or the non-fair trade, organic or the non-organic. And we have to also educate ourselves as consumer. And that helps with the labeling, but it also helps if we, all of us, think about what we buy. You vote with your feet. You vote with what you buy. And I see that's what we need to think about in MC 13, 14, and 15.
Thank you.
From my side, my wish for the policymakers and for the ministers who have gathered here this week is to get into a meaningful dialogue, not only from the members introducing the measures at the moment, but also in a meaningful dialogue, listening in into the problems, concerns, but also experiences of the countries that are on receiving end of such measures, so that we can emerge from this dialogue in a world where sustainability is really supported through the value chains.
Thank you, Yeva. Asad?
Thank you. So in my view, I think this is a moment of celebration. We have come a long way in the last 10 years. I see unprecedented attention and political commitment to making global economy and finance much more fair and greener. I do see that there are disagreements, but in my view, disagreements are not a bad thing. It is that issues are being discussed very seriously and taken seriously. not having a debate on any issue is probably a bad sign. As you said in the beginning, we see that sustainability and the social equality issues are at the center of debate in many forums, including this MC13. And I do believe that it will give us a pathway to the future where we can all come together to create a better world and a healthy planet.
Thank you, Asad. Peter.
Thank you. I've been practicing this one-liner for the past week. You can help me build on it, but to make the inclusion of smallholders into deforestation-free value chains an investment case, we need to move beyond simply making the polluters pay. We also need to start paying the cleaners. Thank you.
A big thank you to all panelists. Thanks for the great session. All the best.